Donald Trump's gone ahead and announced a stimulus package in wake of the spread of the coronavirus. While the U.S. president is trying to shore up the economy, that's bound to take a hit. Other countries have tried to rope in central banks to provide some boost. The problem lies in the fact that no one is quite being able to gauge the impact of the coronavirus spread. So where does it leave the already fragile global growth? Joining us now to talk about that and what does it the impact on India is India Chief Economist at Nomura, Sonal Varma. Sonal, good having you. Thanks much for joining in. The GDP prints of the Asian economies will be hit in quarter four and in quarter one and quarter two of the next year as well. How difficult is it to assess what happens to different asset classes and whether they are pricing in these scenarios already?
Yeah, Neeraj, I think, first of all, there's a lot of uncertainty on how this will play out because it all boils down to how global infections pan out, you know, when the infection rates peak. So as you said rightly, China in the first quarter clearly has seen a big slowdown. And for Asian economies, the growth hit in Q1 has to a large extent, but not entirely, but to a large extent has been because of the supply chain disruptions because of China. And then there's, of course, some slowdown because of, you know, lower tourism. Countries like Singapore, Korea also impacted because of local social distancing measures. What has really changed in the second quarter is, as you know, the infections are now outside China. And with US and Europe going into a lockdown, the final demand for Asian countries, which are very open export-driven economies, the final demand is now slowing down. Also, in a lot of countries, you know, and India is one of them, local infections have started to increase. So we've also seen countries domestically now impose more either lockdowns or social distancing measures. So from India to Philippines, Malaysia, Indonesia, a lot of countries are actually imposing local restrictions. So in this environment, even domestic demand will slow down because if you cannot get out, you know, you're not going to consume or produce anything. So first quarter was really more of supply chain disruptions in China and its impact. Second quarter is going to be about final demand slowing down and domestic demand slowing down in these economies. So outside of China, it actually looks like second quarter will see a bigger hit on growth as compared to the first quarter.
So, when you look at India, Sonal, in your assessment, looking at all that's happened and looking at all that's happening in the world within and within India too, will it be the inward looking economy that gets impacted more because the gig economy and the resultant spend and the travel and tourism industry related consumer sector is dead, or because the world is so fragile that the export oriented part of India will get impacted more?
No, I think at this stage, what we can say is the growth impact in first quarter and the growth impact in second quarter, which I said, you know, like I said, which is April to June, is going to see the biggest economic hit as far as India and also a lot of other economies are concerned. Now, you know, the main uncertainty is with respect to the infection rates. And because the infection rates are increasing at an exponential rate, the probability of social distancing measures extending beyond 15 days is fairly high. So I think unless we see, you know, some plateauing out in infection rates globally, we will see some of these lockdown measures or social distancing measures continue. And the longer they continue, the longer there will be a disruption to business activity and there will be a negative impact on consumer activity. Therefore, cash flows for businesses and especially businesses in some of the services sectors and income flow for some of the daily wage earners will be adversely impacted. So in that situation, what you will in any case typically see is a slowdown in capex and a slowdown in consumption. But in this case, the point is that because of the restrictions, in any case, there cannot be, full production or full consumption. So the nature of the COVID-19 shock is very different. And unless we see infections actually peak out, I think it's very hard to make an assessment of the economic damage and therefore whether, markets have fully priced this in.
Okay. The other bit is, are you trying to make a distinction between urban and rural economy? Because this growth slowdown is likely to have a larger impact to a lot of people's minds for urban growth in compared to rural growth. So are you making that distinction? And would you believe that agri growth would largely be stable at this 3.5%, even though unseasonal rains might have impact on the rabi production?
I would not make too much of distinction between rural and urban consumption. I think overall consumption in India has slowed quite materially. And it is true that it's really the discretionary side of consumption which will see a bigger hit because of COVID-19 in particular. So the decline will be larger in the discretionary side of consumption. So to that extent, you could say that urban consumer will be impacted more. Rural incomes are also going to be impacted indirectly because the price of food, which had started to increase, has again started to moderate. So as far as rural terms of trade, because of that, are sort of reversing. Also, some of these rural workers are employed in construction activity. They are also daily wage earners. Rural India now is not just farm income. A substantial part of rural income actually comes from non-farm activity. So the greater you see measures, stricter measures being imposed by states, there will be indirect effect even on rural income. So I would not, like I said, maybe yes, discretionary gets hit a bit more right now, but there will be indirect effects even on rural side of consumption. Having said that, I do want to add that at this stage, the priority across countries has to be on ensuring that infections slow. That obviously, as we've seen with China, comes at a very high economic cost. But that is a cost countries have to bear in order to prevent, bigger problems down the road.
Okay. One final question, Sonal, while we're talking about the uncertainty around the economic impact due to coronavirus, what about India's own financial sector? I mean, Yes Bank has thus far been handled well. We'll have the moratorium lifting now as well. What happens to the fragile financial sector in India, and what do you make of the way it's been handled?
Well, I think we need to still remain extremely vigilant as far as financial sector risks are concerned. The immediate thing, of course, everybody is watching is what happens once the deposit moratorium, is lifted. We would expect the RBI to ensure adequate liquidity as the lender of last resort to Yes Bank to ensure that there isn't a liquidity problem. But I think it's really the spillover effects of what has happened with Yes Bank that we need to watch in terms of the deposit outflows we are seeing from some of the smaller private sector banks, the impact this has had on, in general, the bank confidence of the banking sector. The capital losses has to be borne, for instance, on the 81 bond. So there are spillover effects from Yes Bank that we need to monitor. The COVID-19 will also have some impact on the banking sector because the lending to SMEs, wherever there are cash flow problems because of COVID-19, because business has come to a complete or has to a large extent slowed down, there will be cash flow problems. And this is going to particularly be visible for the, SME segment, for some of the services, your airline, hotel, retail, etc. So to what extent that filters into the banking sector is something we need to monitor. Also, to the extent that companies were reliant on dollar funding to make onshore payments, we need to also keep a close eye on that. The entire shadow banking, tighter credit conditions impact, in our view, is still playing out. So the ability of specifically the commercial real estate developers, the SMEs to raise money on time is something we still need to monitor. And, you know, the impact of all of this on the asset quality cycle of shadow banks and banks and overall, you know, credit conditions. As you know, credit, even for the corporate bonds, spreads have started to widen again. So I don't think it's an all clear yet. As far as financial sector is concerned, there are risks. And for India, you know, we are now facing both the global COVID shock and the domestic financial sector issues at a time where growth is already very, very weak. So I think we need to be extremely vigilant on credit risks in the coming months.
For sure, it's a clear and present danger, and we'll watch out for that. Sonal, thank you so much for joining in today.
Thank you.
All right, that's Sonal Verma of Nomura with her thoughts. Thanks for tuning in to this broadcast.